In 1972, the Cape Verdean American Veterans Association formed the Cape Verdean Census Committee, whose goal was to recognize Cape Verdean Americans as a racially mixed ethnic group with a distinct cultural heritage and proud history and deserving of a separate listing in the United States Census.
That census committee worked for a couple of years to develop a census, develop the census form and have Cape Verdeans added to it, and that morphed into the Cape Verdean Recognition Committee.
The first Cape Verdean Recognition Day celebration was held on July 8, 1973. Festivities included a cultural program at the Cape Verdean Vets Hall, comprised of Cape Verdean music, folkloric dance, food, and booths representing each island and staffed by Cape Verdean American descendants. In response to the enthusiastic turnout, the Cape Verdean Recognition Committee was formed. 1 year later, 1974, the first Cape Verdean Recognition Parade was held as part of a week-long celebration.
So when we had Cape Verdean Recognition Week, for a whole week, what we did is we had exhibits at the Verdean Vets Hall. This is an example of one of them. This is an article from the Providence Journal magazine with pictures from the Cape Verde Islands and articles about the Cape Verdean communities in Providence and in New Bedford. So this would have been on display in the Verdean Vets Hall throughout the whole week. There would be a banquet one night. We'd have the achievement awards and the scholarship awards. And at the end of that same week, there'd be the big parade, the Cape Verdean Recognition Parade. And it's important, people get confused these days and they think that the Cape Verdean Recognition Parade is an Independence Day parade, a celebration of Cape Verdean independence. We were celebrating Cape Verdean recognition before there was a Republic of Cape Verde. Before independence, the Cape Verdeans of New Bedford were celebrating recognition because we thought it was very important to have America recognize that we existed in this country. So it's all these other Cape Verdean communities now have Cape Verde Independence Day celebrations, but we started it here first. We were recognizing Cape Verdeans in America before anybody else.
At one time, they did ask us, why do you make the parade? What is the purpose? I said, well, the actual name of the parade is the Cape Verdean Recognition Committee Parade. And that usually answers the question. We wanted all Cape Verdean organizations to be in the parade, to be recognized, because at that time, not too many people knew what a Cape Verdean was. Of course, the parade got bigger and bigger every year. They used to compare it with the parade up north, But I said, that's the media. You cannot compare it. Their parade is entirely different, and they have a fantastic parade. So you can't say ours was better than theirs or whatever. You know? That's the media to get you excited to go see the parade, I guess.
In the early days of Cape Verdean recognition, this was sort of parade central. This is the home of my parents, Manuel and Matilda Lopes. And for the weeks before every parade every year, everybody would come here to put together the floats. These are remnants of a couple of the floats. As you can see, every year, well, you can see this one had a theme. Every year, the Cape Verdean recognition celebration had a theme. Like maybe one year they're celebrating the boxers, another year it's all the doctors. The theme in 1982 is today's Cape Verdean youth, tomorrow's leaders. Okay, so with each theme, it meant that there was a celebration of the banquet where they had a person who received the certificate of merit or an honorary certificate, and that person represented that profession. Maybe it was an educator, maybe it was some kind of, maybe it was an athlete, maybe it was a doctor. And so the family would come here. My father made all of these different, my father was very handy, and he made these, all the letters he carved out by, he used his saws, he made these. If you can recognize these letters, you also recognize the craftsmanship from in front of the Verdean Vets Hall with this insignia for the Verdean Vets. These are all made by the same hand. So we have the Cape Verdean recognition, 1982 theme, today's Cape Verdean youth, love this hand, are tomorrow's leaders, okay? And everything painted, I love the fact everything's painted in the old colors, red, green, and yellow. This is right after independence. Okay, here's another example. The theme this year was Cape Verdean recognition is the key to the Cape Verdean world. So of course we have a giant key showing that we're the key to the Cape Verdean world. And the different keys to the Cape Verdean world, education at home, just as important as education in the schools, music and dance, social events, employment, gotta have a job, and sports. Okay, so these big signs with the cornerstone to the floats. The floats are usually part of a truck, and people would be here, and for weeks my cousins, aunts, and uncles would be here making flowers out of tissue paper, putting streamers together. And so the night before every parade, this yard was filled probably with one float, maybe two, and they would take these floats out to be in the parade. But it was a family affair. Thank you.
the first two parades were done by someone else. And Eddie and I decided to take it over, just the two of us, no one else in the committee. And I think we, for 1 year, we did it as a previous committee did. In other words, the vets were last in their own parade. So when we had a meeting for the following year, I asked them, why are you last in your own parade? I mean, that's a little ridiculous in my point of view. And so it was changed. Of course, I stayed at Butwood Park. I had already drawn my plans where to place each unit, and I asked the police department to clear the road in Rockdale Avenue so we could put the cars and the floats that are in the parade. So it became easier for me. With a loudspeaker handheld, I was able to call the units, and all they had to do was march out of Butwood Park down to the street. If they had a float, parade, or a truck, or a bus, then I would call for that bus because I had everything all written on paper. And we did it, I think, for, I forget, 25 years or so. I enjoyed it. When others would ask, why am I doing such a parade and how do I get it going? I said, well, I keep in mind kids. You make a parade so that the kids are happy. And if the kids are happy, the folks are happy. And I kept that in mind.
As soon as you see a really great precision marching band come through, the enthusiasm, the crowd just roars, and they're hungry for that. And I noticed that it's not just older people, but the kids too. They get really excited about that because they haven't seen it. This is something novel for them. We've seen the great precision groups come through.
When you have a unit that comes out, a marching band, that any particular type of unit that's good, people will, it's like their ears perk right up, and they you can see it in their demeanor that they take the interest. The interest rate level just rises.
Quite busy, by the way. You almost had to prepare 1 year at a time, because at that time we had our own corps, which means they were knowledgeable about other corps in the area and out of the area. So they would give us the names and I would write to them.
The Cape Verdean Veterans Association and Ladies Auxiliary, along with community members, formed the first Cape Verdean Marching Unit in 1965. The unit consisted of drums and all female majorettes and was known as the Golden Clovers. Later, the organization purchased horns and flags.
That was a very unique thing to happen out of the Verdean Vets Hall. I don't know whose idea it was to bring drum corps. I don't know who within the Cape Verdean community, within the veterans organization, knew about drum corps. So they put together a drum line and a color guard. I was in the color guard. By ROTC training, I learned how to carry a rifle. I knew how to march. So I immediately started carrying a rifle in the color guard. But I think we were all evolving, and before I don't, within that first year of developing the Corps, I became color guard captain. Then we got a horn line. The next year, we got a horn line. We worked out all winter long, fall, getting ready, and we went out with a horn line. We probably had about 21 horns, and for that time, that's a small Corps, you know, because the Corps were 40 horns and 50 horns and 60 horns. But we had a sweet sound.
Musicians from the Cape Verdean Ultramarine Band Club and other community members taught young men to play the horns.
The instructors were part of that team. The horn and drum line and drill instructors. There were people in the first year, local Cape Verdean man, horn player, conducted the music, taught the young people how to play horns, how to read music, which is, at that time, a lot of early drum corps, they weren't learning how to read music. They were just mimicking, you know, with notes. Oh, play this note and we'll keep trying it, and when you get it right, you got it. Well, this particular gentleman in the community taught the music. And so that made the Verdean Best Drummer Bugle Corps horn line very sweet sounding, very clean. And I used to like conducting it, because that's what I used to conduct it. And I used to get into it.
With the increased numbers, the group became the first full-fledged Cape Verdean Drum and Bugle Corps in the United States. The Corps marched in numerous city and regional parades prior to the creation of the Recognition Day Parade.
Well, it was pride. It was pride. Remember, we were the first Cape Verdean unit like that in the country. And we're going out. People are going to see us. They're going to see us Cape Verdean kids out there doing our thing. And I was 16 at the time. And we're doing our thing. And they loved us. And the crowd was really great. They appreciated us and screamed and hollered and clapped. And, wow, go get them. And then you hear your name called. And then they who's calling me? Somebody's calling me. You know, then you see family, and they're out there, they're all excited. So it was a lot of excitement. I don't know what it was. I mean, I was a shy person, mind you. I'm very shy, low self-esteem, doubting myself. And here I am standing out in front of hundreds of people, you know, leading, at the time, a color guard that day, eventually evolving to the point where I was assistant drum major.
Women from the Ladies Auxiliary and the community designed and created the uniforms.
The uniforms, I want to say this. The Verdean Best Drummer Bugle Corps was put together by a lot of people. People were up late the night before that very first parade, still putting the uniforms together. They were sewing uniforms and putting them together well after midnight, mind you. Quite a few women out there. And the men of the Verdean Vets, obviously, they're getting equipment ready. Everybody was up late. I think it was just the members that went to bed early because we got to get up to go to a parade, and I didn't realize this was still going on. So in the morning, I'm putting on a uniform that, you know, maybe I had tried it, you know, I was fitted for it, but I probably put it on for the first time. And I remember it was tight, and I had a little tam, you know, French beret, I guess it was, with a yellow bonbon on it, I guess you call it. It was white. And my uniform was all white, and they put a stripe on it. It was a pair of pants that I had to buy special from a clothing store on Water Street. And they were Farrah slacks. I remember that well. Kind of stiff, but yeah. And I remember wearing, we used to wear white bucks. And we used to get kidded about white bucks. You know, you have to go through a lot of trouble to get white bucks for our feet. They were considered marching shoes.
The group would undergo several name changes before it disbanded.
One of the main reasons of the many that we were successful is that we scheduled our parade to be the closest to July 4, always on a Saturday. And of course, July 4 was a Bristol, Rhode Island parade. And they have the best corps in the country. So we used to write to them. I told them, think about it. You get paid for the Bristol, Rhode Island parade. On your way home, stop at the vets, for another one or two hours, we pay you, it's like extra money, and then you continue on home. Because they slept in sleeping bags in a bus. One year we had them sleep at the Army barracks that were empty at Fort Rodman. We got permission and with their sleeping bags, that's where they slept.
The parade began at Buttonwood Park, proceeded east on Union Street to Acushnet Avenue. South on Acushnet Avenue to Grinnell Street. West on Grinnell Street to Purchase Street. And north on Purchase Street, ending at the Cape Verdean American Veterans Hall and Reviewing Stand.
I'm not sure, but I don't think they went down Acushnet Avenue at the beginning. And why not? That's where all the Cape Verdeans live. That's why we go beyond the vets all the way to Grinnell. That's most of the Cape Verdeans lived on Purchase Street in that area. The parade is 2.6 miles, by the way. It's a long way. Mm-hmm. It lasted one, 2 or 3 hours. It only lasted that way because the police would stop the parade and let the traffic go on the intersecting streets. It wasn't a long time, but I can see it because people who didn't know the parade route, that maybe they're trying to get somewhere important. And that's one of the reasons that there's a lot of space between one unit and the other. And you had to judge it or arrange it so that no two bands can be heard at the same time. You would hear one at a distance, but the one in front of you was playing loud, so that's what you really hear.
And of course, the parade was done in our community. More or less, a lot of people thought that was the 4th of July parade. But it was not. It was the parade that was coordinated, and all the work was done by the Cape Verdean Veterans Association to make it as nice as possible. It was a very nice experience, and I was proud to be part of that because a lot of people recognize us because we always marched in the parades of 4th of July here in New Bedford prior to that time. So I think a lot of people even today think that our parade is the 4th of July parade, but the city doesn't even have a 4th of July parade anymore.
The parade is always on a work day. It's the people of town, they're happy. Thousands of people watch the parade. And while they're here, they may as well just go across street and live uptown. So the city was very happy to see that, and of course the businesses. We didn't think about that, but it turned out to be a good thing.
In addition to the drum and bugle corps, organizations from across the country participated in the parade throughout the years.
I wrote to every group. I wrote to every Cape Verdean organization, club, or any organized meeting or committee that was Cape Verdean, I would write to them all that we knew. And they would always send a contingent. It's maybe large or maybe small, but they always did. Other organizations, a lot of them made floats, and they would advertise the name of their organization, their club or whatever. I tried to put the Queen in every parade. And there were times there, we got Miss New Bedford, and sometimes we got Miss Massachusetts. The Friendly Sons of St. Patrick, every year they came, and they say we will be doing this for every year that you have a parade. And that was fascinating, but more fascinating about that is usually we pay groups with a band. They would not accept money. They paid for the band in the Boston that were kilts. Yeah, they were the kilts. They paid for that band to come march and operate.
For those of us that participate military-wise, it's an honor. That's the only way I can put it. Those that come out, and we do all. That's one time that I can say that we have a good turnout. You know, guys come from out of town, and we do have members all over the country.
I don't think there's ever been a break in the parade. It's every year. And by the same token, we were lucky or blessed. Neither were we ever rained out. Well, I remember one parade was cloudy, and we didn't know what we were going to do. So we called Boston Weatherman. We would have been better off if we licked our fingers and put it up and see if it was damp. They couldn't tell us what the weather was going to be on the next day. But as soon as the parade ended, the last unit hit Walnut Street, and it poured. I said, yeah, the good Lord watches us every year.
I was part of the Color Guard since day one, since 60 years ago. I was proud to be able to represent our organization and what it stood for, you know what I mean? And we're the only one of its kind in the United States. Cape Verdean Veterans Association and Auxiliary.
Of course, as time went by, the veterans got smaller and smaller. So a few passed away, and others were getting too old to march. But I'm glad I did it. I think everybody pays attention to it. They wait for it. Cape Verdeans from throughout the country come down to be in the parade or watch the parade every year. So, you know, I hope a lot of people enjoyed it, which I think they did. But I hope they remember it, you know, because it's getting smaller and smaller.
Now the church has a float. The vets used to make a float, but we don't make a float anymore. Our band club used to have a float. United Social Club used to have a float. But see, the fact that the people that were involved were all gone.
Edward J. Rogers became president of the Cape Verdean Recognition Committee in the early 2000s. He also served as chair of the Parade Committee. In 2007, the Recognition Committee separated from the Cape Verdean American Veterans Association and became an independent 501c3 organization. 2008, the traditional parade route was changed for the first time in over 30 years.
With the Cape Verdean Recognition Parade Committee 5 years ago as a volunteer, and the following year I was nominated to be on the Cape Verdean Recognition Board, which does the scholarships and the parade. And this year, actually, I became the co-chair of the parade right along with Frank Barrows for the 40th annual Cape Verdean Recognition Parade. Lots of fun.
Parade marshals for the 2012 parade were the founding members of the Cape Verdean Recognition Committee. They were represented by Stephanie Correa.
She was the only one that was well enough to come to the parade this year. I first met Stephanie at the ceremony at the New Bedford Library, and when she spoke, it was wonderful to hear her speak, because the history that she was talking about, it was emotional and it was absolutely beautiful. I think she's a beautiful lady. I love Stephanie.
The 2012 Parade Committee was comprised of co-chairs JoJo Gomes and Frank Barrows, President of the Recognition Committee, Mary Ann Rogers, Norma Belay, and Diane Gomes, among others.
Everyone did a wonderful job. Come parade day, we were absolutely exhausted. But to see the streets lined with all of those beautiful faces, Cape Verdean faces, and they were universal faces. This isn't just a Cape Verdean parade. It's universal. It's New Bedford's parade, you know. It was absolutely beautiful, and it was absolutely worth it. Every moment.
In 2014, Diane Gomes became chair of the Parade Committee, having served as co-chair in 2013 and as a committee volunteer for 3 years.
I got involved with the parade because it's one of those symbols of our Cape Verdean history. And I wanted to be involved and make sure that it continues. Because we've lost so much of the Cape Verdean staples, I'll call them, for lack of a better term, in the area. From when I was growing up till now, there's not as much as there used to be back in the day when I was growing up. As far as like the Miss Vervette pageant, DeWire used to have something outside during the summer. United Social Club was there. They'd have a big event in the summertime. So there was so much to do to keep you connected to your Cape Verdean roots. And it seems like now there's not as much. But the parade and recognition week is a time when a lot of Cape Verdeans make sure that they have vacation at that time to come home, to be home for recognition week and for ultimately the parade day, which is when most people make sure they're there. So I know there's a lot of Cape Verdean families that have family reunions during that week and weekend because they can kill two birds with one stone. They have everybody come home for the family reunion and at the same time, they can join in the festivities of the parade day.
I still love to go to the Cape Verdean recognition parades because it's our community and everybody loves the Cape Verdean recognition parade. Everybody's Cape Verdean for that one day.
People come from all the way from California and different parts of the country for that. They save their vacations because we still do, as far back as you want to go, you know, in terms of how long did we celebrate. In the beginning, we did it for a week. You know, celebrating for a week, we'd start off with different, trying to do something different each day. And then we cut it down to 3 days, you know, in terms of opening our clubs and trying to do different things.
Parade day is just crazy all day. That's when my adrenaline goes through the roof and I'm like hyper all day. The committee itself reports to the vets at 8 a.m. because we decorate the stage with a big banner that says Cape Verdean Recognition Committee. And we have posters of our sponsors that we have every year. And we have to have the podium and the sound system and everything. So 8 o'clock, everybody meets at the vets. And there's a team at the reviewing stand led by Marianne Rogers for the past, I don't know how many years, that puts that all together. And the rest of us get in a vehicle and we head up to the parade at Buntwood Park. When we get to Buntwood Park, we set up an awning, like a canopy and a table. And we tell people to look for that canopy. And the process is supposed to be when they get to the parade, to the park, the first thing they do is register at the table. When they register at the table, there's two people there that'll look up their name in the lineup and it will give them a card and tell them what division they're in. And then they'll let them know where they are in the park. And we always line up at the top of Union and Buntwood and we use Union Street and Buntwood Park in that general area where the baseball field is. We use that whole entire area to set up all the different groups because we have drum corps coming down with the big buses. We have the tractor trailers with the flatbeds that are coming for people to decorate their floats. So it's chaotic. I mean, there's people everywhere in the street walking. There's people under the trees because they want shade because it's usually really hot on parade day. Thank you. And there's just people everywhere. So the people that are on the committee all year long that hear about the parade, that have experience with the parade, are division leaders. So they're in charge of the division. So they're in charge of when someone comes up to them and says, I'm in your division, I'm with the Biscuit Club, for instance, they know where in the lineup the Biscuit Club goes. So they set them up and they tell them, okay, I have five groups in front of you and you're gonna be the trail. So I need you set up from here back and the Biscuit goes there.
So we're here at Buntwood Park, just unloaded the car, setting up the signs. This year I'm a division leader again and soon I'll get my list and be able to get the parade started and line everybody up so they're in order.
This year we put the parade together a little bit different. Before everyone had their hands in it and we would separate the groups by whether they had music or non-music and whether they were walking or they were in a vehicle and things like that, and that helps us construct the parade. But we have a format that we developed 3 years ago with the what we're going to have at the beginning and the end of each division. So the parade is broken down into the divisions. And the first division is always the honor guard, the veterans, the mayor and his staff, council members, school committee. But we always, never fails, we always have walk-ins. Someone come up to the table and says, I didn't get my registration in by the due date, but can I still be in the parade? And in the past, we have never turned anyone away, as far as I know. I know since I've been involved, we have never turned anyone away. So they walk in that morning and they want to be in the parade. And they have a truck, a pickup truck, and they have big speakers, and so they have music. So it makes it more difficult for us because now we got to put them into a spot that doesn't have music, that has enough space or a group big enough before the next group that has music. And this year, that was our challenge. All the groups that are involved in the parade now, whether they're a marching band or the YWCA is in the parade every year. When I first started, they used to walk in the parade. And now they have a flatbed and they have music. So we put in our letter that we have a float contest now. And Dana DeBarros, who's an employee of New Bedford Cable Access, he's in charge of my float contest. And Dana started the float contest, and I was like, I don't know. I don't know if we have enough people to do that. It's so chaotic at the park. I don't know if we're going to have enough time. And he said he would do it. So we get banners, and we get trophies for most beautiful, most creative, and most cultural. And we rate the floats. But what we've done is Dana is the chair, and then we use committee members as the judges to work along with him. And we can have, sometimes we have either two or three just volunteers from the community. They haven't come to any of the parade meetings or anything, but they're there to just judge the floats. And he does his little spiel with them when they get there, and then they walk around the entire park on the street and everywhere, looking for floats, and they rate the three floats, and the people are presented with the banner so they can put it at the front of their vehicle when they're going down the parade route, and then they have the trophy to display also. So that's helped us a lot because now all the groups that are in the parade, a lot of them want to be on a float so they can be in this float contest and have that accolade, you know, yeah, we're most cultural, you know, and they really celebrate it too when they're in the parade. So it makes the parade more festive as it goes on and as the years have come. And even the groups that are walking or if they're in a small pickup truck, they're also decorating, or they're making sure that everyone has the same shirts on and pom-poms or streamers, or they're throwing candy out to the children and things like that. So it's good because a lot of the groups are getting more involved in the parade. So now another thing that I implemented three years ago is what we call the parade monitors. And the parade monitors, we also use people from the community to be there for us just on parade day. And this year we are going to kind of revamp it and get them a little bit more involved. But what the monitors do as it stands right now is I have a meeting with them before the parade starts. I kind of give them an overview of Buttonwood Park and where the groups are going to be. And before the parade starts, they're assigned to a specific division with the division leader, and they're there to assist the division leader to get that division in line and keep them in line. But they also walk down with the parade. So they walk the entire parade route, and they're in charge of a division, and there's usually two of them together, one in the front and one in the back, and they kind of communicate with each other, which we use a flag system if the parade's stopping or starting so that they know what's going on. And they kind of keep the control and the flow of the parade so that we don't end up with big major gaps, which some gaps are unavoidable. You know, there are some gaps that we get during the parade because we have groups like Tonka Tumblers. They're in the parade every single year, and Tonka Tumblers, they do their routine. So before we had the monitors, the parade would be on its own. So the parade would go down the street, and then by the time it got into the South End neighborhoods, there were big gaps because all the groups were stopping and starting wherever they wanted. the drum corps or the marching bands, if the crowd was like screaming for them, they would be like, oh, we got a good crowd here. Let's just stop here and do our routine. So they would stop and do their little 3-5 minute song. But then there was a gap in front of them. So then for them to catch up, they're marching at their same pace. So sometimes it took a while for them to catch up. Once it gets around Purchase Street, there's kind of a, like a cluster. It ends up being a backlog. Everybody's waiting to come around to get to the reviewing stand. So what we did with the monitors is we decided that we're only going to have 3 spots for the groups to stop. The marching bands and the drum corps, we have them stop. One of the spots is County and Union. The drum corps, we try to have them stop there and play a song and then step off and keep going. And then the next stop, I believe, is Monty's Park. And then the reviewing stand is the 3rd stop. So that kind of keeps the parade flowing. And because the monitors are there, they can stop and start the parade if they see too much of a gap. If they're in the front and they turn around and the group behind them is way behind, they can slow their group down, and then it trickles down to the front of the parade. And then when they slow down and they get back together, it trickles down to the back of the parade, so it kind of keeps them together. So I think we did a much better job since we've had the monitors.
The parade continues to honor its history as they move forward, keeping the parade vital and alive for future generations. There is no greater example of this than the selection of Bernardino Butch Silva as the 2016 parade marshal.
I take it as a honor, you know, the fact that hey, and a lot of people say, they should have done it for you a long time. I say, look, I'm not even worried about it, you know, and yes, I feel proud that, you know, I was selected, you know, but I'm just proud of the fact they asked me to be that person to represent whatever. But it is an honor any time a group of people get together to honor you for, you know, and as you can see over there, I've been involved in my life, you know, so I just thank God the fact that I've been able to do it. And, you know, it's like everybody else. I say, you dread the day you can't do it. And that's what I tell them. I said, hey, I'll do it as long as I can.
Because we want the parade to be entertaining. We want people to watch the parade and be clapping and stamping their feet and saying, yeah, look at so-and-so, or I know him, or I know her, and see familiar faces and familiar things. But also, like you said, the parade was started and Recognition Week was started to celebrate and recognize our Cape Verdean history, our Cape Verdean culture. So we will always have that as our mission.